Well, thank you for being here today. Thank you for being here today. I have Amanda Stockton, Mandy over here, and Alexis Kumsia. The front 17 rows are her friends. And we want to talk to you about our weakness. We also have some friends from Colombia here today. Quiero decir buenos días y bienvenidos a mis amigos de Colombia. Gracias. I just told them thanks for being here and welcome. So today we want to talk a little bit about our weakness. But more than that, we want to brag on God's strength. God is strong. And sometimes, a lot of times, we're weak. Now, when I was young, I sort of understood that I was weak because of a little song I used to sing. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Thanks, Jordan. I heard that. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Sing it if you know it. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Come on, give yourself a hand. That was good. That was good. Two people in the back, don't get chapel credit. You didn't sing. Just kidding. Just kidding. Just kidding. It's a joke. Joke. Well, somehow, after being young and singing that song and understanding that I really was weak and that God was strong, somehow I grew up. And in growing up, I think I forgot about being weak. Because all I could see was, I'm the man. I can handle this. I can do this. I'm strong now. Until the lessons of life sort of helped me to figure out that I wasn't so strong after all. Fact is, I probably shouldn't be here today. I was taking a friend back to the airport in Atlanta just before Christmas. I was driving back to Cleveland in the cold and the rain and coming back actually to have supper with a recent graduate. And I was in my truck on I-75 coming north when I hit the bridge over Lake Altoona. I moved onto the bridge, and at that point everything sort of became a blur. It became a blur until I came to a complete stop. My rear wheels lost traction and I started to hydroplane on the bridge. At that point, my life sort of went into slow motion, and what I was seeing, I wasn't pleased with. I held on tightly to the steering wheel and I sort of braced myself for the impact. I didn't try to correct my direction because if I had, the truck would probably gone into a huge spin or maybe even flipped. But when I hit, I slid across three lanes of traffic. I hit the bridge, the concrete wall at the end of the bridge, and it caved in about 2 feet on the front of my truck. I was stopped at the wall and I didn't break through it. I didn't flip over it and fall down into the lake about 30 or 40 feet below. But I was there trying to figure out what was going on, and I turned to the left and all of a sudden I see this horse trailer screaming down the bridge at me, and it impacted the side of the truck, busted the window, and glass shot all over the cab of the truck. Trust me, I was shaken, but I wasn't injured. I stepped out of the truck and only a small scrape on my left shin where my shin had hit the dashboard on impact. But I'll never forget the feeling of helplessness that I experienced that day. There was literally nothing I could do. I was vulnerable and weak, and if it hadn't been for God's provision, I wouldn't be here today. Reality is, none of us sitting on stage should probably be here today. But the only reason we're here is because of God's strength and because of God's provision in our lives. And if I can be so blunt as to say it, I need you to just tell you all this morning, go ahead and get over yourselves. because you guys are weak too. All of us are. See, we want to pride ourselves on being able to handle life and all of its ups and downs, but when we get down to the nitty-gritty, we can't handle it. We can't handle it because we're weak. I know some of you guys are probably sitting back there right now saying, dude, I don't know who you're talking to, but I ain't weak. Well, after chapel, cash me outside. How about that? Yeah, I did. And I will tell you how weak you are, okay? Sorry. Was that inappropriate for chapel? I'm sorry. Now, maybe not today. Sure, maybe not today. Maybe not now. Maybe not this very moment. Because right now, you might be at the top of your game. You might be hitting your stride. You might be completely legit in being able to handle anything in life. You might be able to handle anything that life throws at you. You could be the best of the best right now. But I promise you, there will come a day when you aren't the man and you aren't the woman you think yourself to be. There will come a day when you feel like giving up. There'll come a day when you feel like nobody cares. There'll be a time when you're not at the top of your game. There will be a day when you aren't the best. There'll be times when there's nothing you can do to fix things. There'll be face seasons in your life when you feel like everything is turned upside down. You'll face difficulties and tough times and you won't be strong. It might be relationships. It could be your past. Could be how you view the world around you or how the world has treated you. Or maybe it's a loss in your life. There'll be times that you'll be weak. There'll be a time in your life that you might feel like you shouldn't really be here. But take heart. John 16:33, Jesus said, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart because I have overcome the world. Now, I don't want to read too much into this particular scripture, but the implication is this. Jesus implies that since I have overcome, you also can overcome. If you have a relationship with me, you can overcome the trouble of this world. Revelation 12, John said, and they overcame him, the enemy that they were fighting against, by the blood of the Lamb. See, we're saved by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. So our testimony to you today is that God is greater than your greatest struggle, that God is bigger than your biggest issue, that God is stronger than your fiercest battle. So listen to our stories today. See our weakness. But please understand that God is strong, and the strong God that you can serve wants to take care of you.
I'd like to start with a quote. This is from Jesus Calling by Sarah Young. Your weakness does not repel God. It attracts his power, which is always available to flow into a yielded heart. A yielded heart doesn't whine or rebel when the going gets tough. It musters courage to thank God even during the hard times. Thank you, Pastor, for inviting me to share today. I want to start by saying I really shouldn't be here. In fact, if you were to see parts of my story, you would say the same. I'm amazed that I'm here at this point in my life. I'm amazed that I am on this stage today. By all human predictions and assumptions, I should not be here. I shouldn't have taken the road that I did. I should be on an entirely different path. My weaknesses and adversities should have held me back. I shouldn't have succeeded in school, shouldn't have gone on to college, later work at an incredible place like Lee University. So what do I mean? You might be thinking, well, I'm going to share that with you today. It all began here, and I'm going to ask if they will flip to a picture on the slides. I figured that today I should bring like the humiliation full circle and just share some really awkward family photos with you. So this is me as a baby. It all began here. I grew up in a very rural area of Mississippi, in fact. Dirt, gravel roads, 30 miles from town. This is me as probably about a 4 month old. I was a cute baby, right?
Yeah.
I was the middle of three girls, and yes, before, as you're thinking of it, yes, I definitely felt middle child syndrome. It was certainly evident in how I felt and how my family perceived me. My family was classified below middle income, so there was definitely a level of poverty in how I grew up and even into my adolescence. So I'm very thankful, though, despite that, I never went hungry. I never lacked clothes, food, a place to live. I had a very devoted mother who took us to church every Sunday, Wednesday, revivals, all the things. And she made sure we were connected to faith and a godly community. I'm going to ask them to flash to the next picture. And this is a picture of me and my sisters. Where does the I'm not supposed to be here part come from? Where does that statement come from? Well, let me tell you the story. I remember one night I was about 10 years old, probably around the age of the picture on the left. My mom and sister, older sister and I were coming home from church, and we had been at something called a singing. Now notice there's not a G at the end of singing. And as implied, there was a lot of singing. And it was a wonderful service. I was a person who loved music, still do. I sang from a very early age, and so it was a pretty great service for me. I got to sing myself. I enjoyed good people singing, spent time with some family there and friends. I come home and thought, wow, this night could not get any better. So when we got home, we entered our home through the kitchen like we always did. My dad was sitting there in the kitchen. Again, pretty normal. He was drinking a beer, listening to his country music. Pretty normal for my dad. But I saw that he had a gun laid across his lap. And that was not normal. That was unusual for this particular night. I didn't know what was going on. Again, I was only about 10 years old. My sister and I, we went ahead for bed. We changed for bed. I heard my mom talking to him and trying to persuade him to give her the gun. He was angry, he was yelling. Finally, he relented and he gave her the gun. And she took it and she actually placed it in me and my sister's bedroom closet. She brought us the rest of Dad's guns, but didn't really tell us why, except that we needed to keep them for the night in our room, in our closet, and sleep with the bedroom door locked. I heard Dad go into their bedroom. They both went to bed. That was it. Nothing was ever said. And that was the end of that story. So our minds are really funny. You'll notice as you get older, they just remember the most interesting things, things that you think you'll never need to remember later or want to remember later. Despite time and distance, they're just some things we never forget. You see, most people didn't know what kind of environment that I actually lived in. Most people thought, you know, it's probably a fairly normal home. Two sisters that I have, my mom, we go to church. Maybe my dad's too busy to actually come to church. But the reality was we were living in a very volatile, disruptive home, a very dysfunctional home. My dad was quite angry often. We later understood, and this was way later into adult years, did I understand he had clinical depression. He also suffered with bipolar. And he was not on medication for many, many, many years. We didn't know if he was going to try to harm himself, if he was going to try to harm us. He would yell. He would scream. Sometimes he would come home, and he would be in a good mood. And those were good days. But we never knew what kind of day it was going to be. So it was a very confusing and unsettling environment that I grew up in. Our community saw our family, and again, maybe they thought we were a pretty good family. And my dad, he worked a lot, so he wasn't at church. But the truth was, he wasn't at church because he worked too much or needed to work too much. He was quite angry about God and with God. He would curse God pretty frequently. He would curse us. He would curse the people that we went to church with. So needless to say, all of these things took a toll. The truth was we were quite fragile, living in a home filled with dysfunction, alcoholism, constant verbal abuse, semi-poverty, lacking in peace. I never heard my dad say, "I love you," until later on, many years later, after I was married and out of the home. So the overall environment took its toll, and in a might-have-been confident young lady, and I'm talking about myself, felt very weak. I felt very powerless. I felt unworthy of anything good in my life. So as I said before, my mom took us to church religiously, and that becomes something very important to me. It was the lifeline that I held on to. That connection to faith and people, it changed my life. A life that the enemy would otherwise have chosen to destroy if he could have. Any way he could have destroyed me, he would have. I started reading my Bible very young, probably around age 6 or 7. Didn't understand what I was reading. It was one of those really old paperback Bibles that have like the pink edged paper, and there's no like devotional or app that I could refer to. I'm not going to tell you how old I am, but I didn't have a cell phone. So that was a long time ago. But there was nothing explained to me what God's word meant. So I had to really rely on prayer, reading the word, trusting those that were at church with me, Bible study teachers, preachers, and to help me understand. I had a grandmother that poured her life into me, and that helped me as well. So God became very real to me and began to speak to me through dreams, a still small voice. I would feel his presence in a very real way. He even allowed me to minister to other people. And as a child, that's still just a very strange memory for me, to be praying for people and ministering to others. So when I think back to those horrible memories, there was a lot I could continue to share. There's a lot of stories. I just chose the one to share with you. There are things that have wounded me. They've scarred me. I don't see them, though, the same way anymore. There was a time in my life where that's all I could see was the damage. But I don't see it that way anymore. I'm amazed that I survived without being physically abused, without Dad taking his own life or our life. It was a miracle the way that God kept me in all of this. I'm reminded when I see those scars of the pain, yes, but I also think back to God's goodness and his strength. When I was a lonely, weak, scared little girl who didn't feel like she was worth anything and grew up that way, it was many years later before that changed for me, I think back to God's protection. I think back to his voice in the night when I would have another nightmare and nowhere to turn. God was there when no one else was. I see his hand in my life today. I see it in my wonderful husband's face, in my children's face, in the career that I'm in the life that he's given me. So I stand before you scarred. I'm weak. I don't have it all together. I still feel damaged sometimes. I may have begun with telling you I shouldn't be here, but I want to end with this scripture. In 2 Corinthians 12:9, if you guys would put it on the screen, and you can read the actual scripture that's there, but I want to quote it to you in this way, and I want you to receive this today for you and where you're at and how you're feeling. Here is what God says to you and to me. My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. So Lee community, students, faculty, staff, most gladly can we boast of our infirmities, in our weaknesses, our past, our insecurities, that Christ and the power of Christ may rest upon us. Thank you.
So like the two of them, I'd like to start off by saying that it's only by God's work that I'm here. Dr. O'Bannon, whom most of you know, B.O.B., Battle O'Bannon, did missions years and years ago, at one point doing mission work in Syria. For those of you that know the Donay siblings, their father is originally from Syria. It was there that Dr. O'Bannon met him and helped him acquire a passport to come to the United States. After spending some time in the United States, Mr. Dene ended up doing some missions work in Bethlehem, where he was a principal at a school. My dad actually just so happened to go to that school. Along the way, he became family friends and actually led my dad to Lee University, where my dad walked on the soccer team, met my mom, who was on the women's soccer team, and I guess you could say the rest is history. But I bet you'd never guess who my dad's advisor was when he got here. It was Dr. O'Bannon. From one man's work of spreading the gospel, generations of Christians came about, and I'm one of them. Growing up as a Palestinian American wasn't always easy, since my family is Christian. My family is actually one of the largest Christian families in Bethlehem. The reality of it is, we're not all aware of the hardships that come with this, especially today. I decided that I couldn't speak for the conflict until I had witnessed it myself and had the credibility that came with that. And this Christmas, connections that I had made through Lee actually gave me the opportunity to do so. I'd like to preface by saying that I'm not here to argue politics or theology. I'm only here to tell you the story of myself and so many others that don't have the opportunity to do so. All of my traveling was done entirely by myself, and I found out very quickly just how big my family was when the Israeli security in Paris took one look at my passport and knew exactly what my ethnicity was. The American branding on the front of my passport didn't matter much after that because I was associated with an enemy. And they had to make sure that I wasn't an enemy myself. It wasn't necessarily the dumping out of my wallet or the pouring out of my book bag or even the searching through my phone and laptop that got to me. It was the security guards walking only myself to my seat and standing there until the plane took off when I knew I was powerless. And it's a sad thing to say that I was heading to a place where generations of my family were born and raised, and I felt like I had no place there. I was weak and alone on my way to a country where I wasn't wanted. The first thing you see when you enter Palestine is the wall that separates the Israeli land from the Palestinian land. The wall stretches 440 miles, is 26 feet high, and 10 feet thick of concrete. I actually have a picture of myself with a very powerful mural that was actually painted on the wall. If you can take that. So one of the hardest things to wrap my mind around was that this wall wasn't necessarily keeping anything out of Palestine, but this wall was keeping the Palestinians in. These people didn't have many options for work, and they fought for heaters to keep their concrete homes warm in the winter, when about a 10-minute walk away, there was a life that is decently close to the life we have the privilege of living here in the United States. In fact, most of my cousins in Bethlehem that had grown up there had never even seen Jerusalem. Sometimes I wonder to myself why the birthplace of Jesus falls in the 1040 window. For those of you who don't know what that is, the 1040 window is the area in the world that has the highest number of unreached people groups. I didn't have a great grasp on that upon going there, but once I got there, I began to understand at least a portion of why that is. The devil is so at work there through the spirit of religion and confusion that despite the truth that surrounds them in the form of landmarks, churches, and tradition, there are still misconceptions about Christianity. One of the heaviest moments for myself was when I had a cousin of mine look at me and say, "Alexis, I believe in God. I believe that Jesus died for my sins, but I don't believe in the Bible." You can imagine my shock when he told me that. But he explained it by saying, "You get to take the lessons and the morals that come from the Bible and its stories, but I've grown up seeing the war and division that have been caused by what that book contains." That was when I saw the impact of the devil taking the truth and skewing it just enough to serve himself. And I would argue that that's the source of a lot of confusion and strife in the Middle East. It's not that the people there don't know the Bible, because a lot of them know the Bible inside out, and that includes Muslims. In fact, at a school that I served at there in my time, the ratio on Christian and Muslim students was near 50-50. You would never guess that based on the conflict that the media convinces us of, and I will not deny or downplay the conflict that does exist, but I'm here to attest that it's not everywhere, and the enemy is not always who it's presented to be. Bethlehem is primarily Muslim, but that is only because the West Bank is where most people that did not agree with the radicalism went. The number of Muslims increased in the area, and the number of Christians decreased due to the fleeing of prosecution. Even with all of that said, there were times that I felt safer there than I do in most places in the United States. The way back from Palestine was just as difficult, but I was carrying a new weight with me. I was carrying the weight of the people that I met, the relationships that I had built, and the mistreatment that I had witnessed. I really believe that you're not required to love like Jesus until, in that way, until you've had to interact with people that hate you and your family just for the blood in your veins. I actually have a picture of my family from New Year's. That's not even half, but there's quite a few, but I love them very, very much. Upon coming back, I sat in Pastor Jimmy's office, and I really couldn't do anything but cry because I felt so responsible to do something about my experiences, which I was and I am. But something that you said, Pastor Jimmy, stuck with me. He said, "Alexis, how do you eat an elephant?" And I looked at him for a second, and he said, "You do it one bite at a time." And if you're feeling discouraged on how to change some aspect of this world, just know that it starts with prayer, telling someone, and a single God-led step forward. I'd like to bring up a man in the Bible that most of you know, Moses. Moses was born to slaves, but called to leave those slaves out of slavery. You may feel small, insufficient, or even weak compared to your calling or the message that God has asked you to deliver, but just know that we serve a God that is strong enough and even willing to see it come to fruition. If it weren't for God's provision through the Pharaoh's daughter, Moses wouldn't have been alive to do what he needed to do. If God hadn't appointed Moses' brother Aaron, Moses' speech impediment would have prevented him from delivering the message that God had appointed him to. God can take your obstacle and use it to turn it into a path that leads to full dependence on him. I know what the Bible says about Israel, and while I won't claim to know everything, I am informed on a lot of what comes with that. But today I'm here to deliver a message that the Lord has planted in my heart that may apply to you both immediately and globally. I do not believe that the inevitability of what is happening in the Middle East is any justification to stop praying for its people. So much of what is happening is a result of the human condition, not because we support a God that supports oppression and strife. We can't move forward as humanity and leave behind people groups. My freshman year, one of my teammates on the track team came up to me and said, "Alexis, I was sitting in front of you on the bus on the way to the meet, and God told me something that I'm supposed to tell you now. He has his hand on your life. This is a new season where he's preparing you to send laborers into the harvest. He also may want you to be where your family is overseas. For some reason, I can't figure out what he wants you to do, but I think it's missions." We weren't close, and I'm not sure we'd talked more than twice before that point. So he had no way of really knowing where my family was from, but that was when I received the call, and my senior year I did see it come to fruition. It didn't make any sense to me at the time, and I sort of let it go. However, I quickly learned that God is a God who keeps his promises, even when we don't feel there's a way, and even when it doesn't make sense. That's because in our weakness, he is our strength. Thank you.
As you can see, life sometimes takes on different things that help us to understand just how weak we really are. And honestly, life is a battle any way you look at it. But it's like Mandy and Alexis have said today, the enemy's not always who we think the enemy is. We have an enemy who seeks to kill, steal, and destroy. Sometimes God just wants to use our weakness to bring about his strength being made perfect. Let me share this story, and then we'll have a time of worship to end our time today. Again, this is not a political statement, but on September 11th, 2001, something took place in New York that made us all feel very weak. Most of you were very young at that point, and many of you don't even remember what took place. But it changed the nation here in the United States for a while. Most of the time, though, I think we easily forget how weak and vulnerable we really are. The USS New York, there's a picture coming up on the screen, was built with 24 tons of scrap steel from the World Trade Center. It's the fifth in a new class of warship designed for missions that include special operations against terrorism. It carries a crew of 360 sailors and 700 combat-ready Marines to be delivered ashore by helicopters and assault craft. steel from the World Trade Center was melted down in a foundry in Amite, Louisiana, to cast the ship's bow section. And when it was poured into the molds on September 9th, 2003, those big, rough steel workers treated it with total reverence, recalled Navy Captain Kevin Winsing, who was present. He said it was a spiritual moment for all of us. Junior Chavers, foundry operations manager, said that when the Trade Center steel first arrived, he touched it with his hand and the hair on his neck stood up. It had a big meaning to it for all of us, he said. They knocked us down, but they can't keep us down. We're going to be back. We will be back. And in case there's any doubt, the ship's motto, never forget. Never forget. See, I wish I could grab each of you by the shoulders and look into your eyes and say that, both historically and futuristically. I wish I could say to you that my life was in shambles, destroyed by the terror of my enemy. Jesus put the broken pieces back together again. See, the weakness of life and sin and the pain has knocked me down, but those things can't keep me down because I'll be back. My weakness does not demand failure because I'm alive and well. And the love and the grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ has rescued me from utter destruction. Not only has he done it for me, but he'll do it again and again and again for every one of you. And all we have to do is call on the name of the Lord. Because when life knocks you down, when you're weak, Jesus is strong enough to carry you through any and every situation. If you are weak, and I know you are, maybe not now, but you will be at some point, you're in a perfect position for God to come into your life and to make something beautiful happen. We have to realize that our life is not about us. 2 Corinthians 12:9, you've heard it already, but God spoke to Paul and he said, "My grace is sufficient for you because my strength is made perfect in weakness." When you're weak, he is strong. And God's grace in any and every situation is always enough to help you make it through.